Leave me alone. Anyway, thanks you guys for all coming. Appreciate it. And thanks to all you people out there who I hope are out there. Hi. Hope you enjoy it.
Get that chat set up.
We really should. Can they, like, say hello?
No. Yeah, we're not that cool yet.
Okay.
So, I'm sorry.
Hi, Namara and Aaron and Robert.
Yeah, here's Roger.
Facebook message him. It's not working.
Yeah.
That's good. All right, so as you all know, we're going to talk about one of my favorite pieces today, one of the composers, Barber, prayers of Kierkegaard. How many people are kind of familiar with the piece already? A little bit? It's one of these pieces that almost never gets performed. Never. Like a lot of Barber's music, to be honest. It's always one of these things that shocks me, and I shouldn't start off by going on a tangent, but, you know, we live in Philadelphia, which is pretty much where Barber was born, in Westchester, and Philadelphia Orchestra premiered a lot of Barber's work, which is awesome. They rarely do it now, and it drives me insane. You know, if I was a Philly Orchestra, if you're listening to Philly Orchestra, just like two pieces every year. I mean, what is the problem? Anyway, the prayers don't get done very often because, first of all, you need a very large orchestra, highly complex orchestration, and an incredibly difficult choral part. Very difficult. it's kind of oddly written for choir because this is in between Barber's two operas, this piece, right? So you get this idea of writing for a very large ensemble choir, like as you would an opera, and yet it's incredibly detailed counterpoint in this piece that makes it very difficult to pull that off. So it takes like the exact right type of choir to do this, first of all. So that's an issue. But technical issues notwithstanding, this piece is pretty special and unique for a lot of ways. I've always wanted to teach a class which would be like post-World War II massive oratorios, right? Because, I mean, it's like, think about how many great pieces are in this, right? You have this piece, the Durfle Requiem, the Britain War Requiem, the Franz Schmidt Book of the Seven Seals, one of my favorite pieces of the movie, the Vaughan Williams, Dona Nobis Pacem, right? The Stravinsky Symphony of Psalms. All these pieces, these massive, quasi-religious, quasi-not, some very religious, some kind of anti-religious pieces, written right after World War II. It's really fascinating. Barber started this piece, I believe, in 1942. Didn't finish it until 1955. It's a long gestation, 56 maybe. Very long gestation on this piece. For a couple of reasons. I mean, World War II actually interrupted a lot of this, and he didn't work for most of that time. But even afterwards, he had a long difficulty completing this piece. I think it's by far the most formally intricate and the most moment-to-moment intricate piece he probably ever attempted. Now, he wrote two operas, which are both long pieces. It's not lengthwise anything close to that. But it's in the form of a symphony, four movements, all attacca, right? No sonata first movement, but a kind of rounded binary first movement. A slow movement, soprano solo, second movement. Then a scherzo, which kind of flows seamlessly into this just wild, panicked rondo slash fugue slash crazy fourth movement, and then the finale. So four movements in the form of a symphony, and yet with a lot of changes that you wouldn't expect. So that's one thing. Now, I also want to talk about what this poetry is and what it's all about. You know, I like to pretend to be a musicologist. It's kind of my favorite thing to pretend to be. Right? And I swear, if I was a musicologist, I could go to town on this piece. And I'll show you as we go along. But are you familiar with Kierkegaard in some ways? You know who he was? Danish philosopher slash religious thinker. Died in 1855. But his writings weren't available in English until 1936. So, very long time. So when Barber was first kind of getting into reading him, it was like the first time that any English speakers had really learned about him. So it was kind of like fresh material to work with, right? He was this kind of anti-philosopher who like believed that all systems of philosophy were actually total BS. It's really interesting, right? And he advocated for like, you know, his Christian thinker, right? So he advocated for like a closer relationship, personal relationship between people and God, like not using the church, kind of anti-establishment guy, which got him, you know, made him a lot of friends, as you can imagine. And so Barber felt pretty strongly about this himself. In his own program notes for the piece, he says something which is pretty interesting. He says, there's three things that I find in all of Kierkegaard's writings that I totally believe in. Imagination, dialectic, and religious melancholy. Interesting three things to list. And if you read Kierkegaard, there's no doubt that's what that's all about, right? And so I usually don't go into this much detail with pieces about the non-musical things, as you guys know who know me talking about this, but I really think it can help understand his decision-making process. This is an incredibly intricate piece that took over 15 years to write, and it's not that long. Okay, so that means every decision was very, very well considered. You know, this is not one of those, you know, Beethoven 8 situations where he, you know, dashes it off and says, ha! Right? This was highly, highly, highly considered. So, very important. I'd like to listen to the first movement because I feel like probably we all are not completely familiar with it, right? So we should probably listen to it. I'm going to stop it. I know it's a taco. It'd be weird to stop it anywhere, but I'm going to stop it after the first movement. But before I do that, I just want to give you a few things to look through in the score, right? So let's just browse real quick through this so we can kind of understand what the formal design is. So we start with this very long chant, basically, Gregorian chant. And then after an imitative passage, we go to this large climax there, number three, rehearsal three, page three. Each broad stroke in this form. Then at rehearsal four, we start the exact same chant, but this time in canon, imitative canon, between the four voices. And since I gave you all the score, you have like my analysis right in front of you for the first time. You get to see what my score is actually looking like, right? And that plays out over the long span. We repeat the entire text in canon with the four voices. That culminates at 6, which is page 9, with the text, but nothing changes. And we have this big climactic ending to this movement. So it's a two-part movement, right? Basically, the presentation of the text, then the first big climactic arrival of the choir, then a canonic presentation of the text, as opposed to the first homophonic one. And then again, that same large climax, and that's it. So not anywhere near a sonata here, right? Basically two large double period phrases. One being the chant by itself, and the other being the imitative counterpart. Okay, let's listen. If you are hanging out over here, you can't see me. Hi, no, you can't see me either. But if you're online, you might want to, if you can't hear us, maybe just pull up a YouTube recording real quick.
I'm just gonna play it.
It's Atlanta Symphony with Robert Shaw, the recording that I like for this. This starts very, very, very quiet. Thank you.
Incredible piece, isn't it?
Yeah.
Let's start breaking it down. Now, right from the beginning, it's going to be, you know how I feel about analysis. We always analyze in time. We always start from the left and move to the right. We never pretend like we can see the future, and we don't live in the past. When we remember things that happen to us, we usually remember them slightly not correctly. And we have to keep this in mind as we analyze. So when you start with this plane chant, and just that alone, you have a whole incredible host of material to draw from, right? So right off the bat, this lower neighbor pitch, right, gives you your first contrapuntal motive. Now, last time, I know some of you weren't here last time, but last time we spoke about different types of contrapuntal motives, right, different levels of contrapuntal motives. The first one being rhythmically fixed contrapuntal motives, right? The second one being intervallic, and the third being a higher level contrapuntal motive, like a concept contrapuntal motive. This is going to have types 2 and 3, and not type 1 for the most part. Now, contrapuntal motives, for those of us who need a refresher, because it's always a good thing to talk about, what are they? Quick definition from the crowd?
They're structural elements in music that are designed to hold a piece together, but not necessarily directly draw attention to themselves.
Well, that's very good. Very good. Anything you want to add?
Always rhythmically bound.
If they're a first level one, right? If they're a first level one, that is true. Right? They're the bricks that make up the wall, right? If the bricks are all the same size and shape, you don't notice them, you just notice the wall. Right? And if they're all the bricks are all the same, they contribute to a feeling of unification inside of one work. So we have that kind of second level contrapuntal motive right there at the beginning. It's not rhythmically bound per se, but a strong feeling of the lower neighbor whole time. Right? As we move, so we feel D minor here because of our tonal ears tell us that until this happens. What pitch was the offending pitch to our D minor feel? Obviously the C natural, right? The B, B made, B natural in English, right? When we say fa sol si fa, we think, oh, okay, well, there's a modulation perhaps. But as we move back down out of that, do si sol mi la la fa mi fa do do re, there's our do re, right? And it's a perfectly reasonable and natural thing to do. We're starting with a plain chant, we're imitating church mode styles of older music, a chant, perfectly fine. And that goes on for a little while. And in fact, before he does anything else, before he changes anything inside this mode, he starts to expand upon the contrapuntal mode. Right? So continuing on. Now here. This is what I would call our contrapuntal mode 2. Right? We've taken that little building block, and now we've added on a full turn above it. Whole tone below, whole tone above. And we have our kind of expanded secondary contrapuntal. All these will come into play as we do the imitation. And here's the beautiful moment that really matters, I think, in this piece, right here. See the crescendo is this for the, this is all male chorus, right? And then all of a sudden, what you'd expect to be subito piano. And for the first time, an introduction of a new pitch, right? The C flat. The C flat is fascinating, isn't it? It makes us feel for a second that we're in sol minor, perhaps. But it also would change our original mode from Dorian back to minor, correct? So what is the effect of that? It's fascinating. To me, this is the crux of the issue here. Notice the text. This is why I talked about it before, right? This whole text so far has been, oh, thou that are unchangeable, and we find our essence, thou art, sorry about God, 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 God. And this is for the very first time he says a human thou. The first time it's been brought from this divine idea back down to like, here's what we're down with, down in this crappy place where we are, right? And for the first time we move, and it's very important, from the modal to the tonal, right? And I don't think that this is an accident. These type of things to me are very powerful. It's an excellent coloration setting of this text. The first time in the text we stop talking about God, we start talking about humans, and all of a sudden we go from the modal world, the old church world of the modes, back into tonal music with that B-flat. Puts us right back into D minor. All right, then this moves the, oh infinite love, is going back to talking about not people, right? jam. Now, all those of you who know how much I love acoustics and over 10 series and all that fun stuff, know that the longer you hear this, all by itself, as all the men are singing this, you're hearing what? The longer it goes on. Are you still hearing the minor?
Oh, are you hearing that dominant seventh?
Yeah. You're starting to hear this. Even though we ended with a hanging fa, the longer he holds this, moderato, according to Eagles 56, the long hold before the instruments come in. You're hearing because that's always what happens when you're reduced to one pitch. You start to hear it as a tonic property, and we start to hear the overtone series being created around it, and we hear that F sharp starting to ramp. And that's exactly what happens. He holds it, and the first pitch we hear, in position, in the first violin, F sharp, in overtone position directly from that pitch. That's your overtone series, right? So it's even in the exact right register. Now, that's perhaps something we'd expect. Now, you don't know this because you're looking at when you're listening to the piece, but he's changed the key signature to F sharp minor, which is highly unusual, right? Because he's ended this thing in D minor, and all of a sudden it has three sharps in it. So when you're looking at the score from an instrumentalist point of view or a singer's point of view, you're like, something's about to happen. But that's all the psychology of notation. In real life, when you're sitting in the hall and you hear the end of the chant, then all of a sudden the conductor's like, violins go like this. You're like, what's it going to be? Can you already hear it? But then immediately the surprise, the next pitch. So you got kind of the surprise you wanted, but then there was another surprise immediately after, and that's the solo show. So not only did we move from that kind of Dorian minor over back to major, but we actually went one mode further around into the Lydian. Right? And so that pushes us all the way to the other spectrum, so the super bright.
Really cool.
From the super dark of the minor of Dorian, but not just to the major, but to the super bright.
And the way he makes that transition is being extremely sensitive to acoustics.
100%. Especially in a big hall with a choir of 200 people, there is no doubt in my mind, right, that that's exactly what you hear. Now, the resultant of this is fascinating. So there's, an implicit pickety third that occurs right there, right? But you do have the F natural that was leapt away from and thus hangs, right? The F natural right here. First pitch you hear. And that right there is going to be our upper level contrapuntal motive, our kind of third level concept contrapuntal motive. It's a cross-relation third. Okay. Now, again, knowing your acoustics, if you have a major chord here and a minor third on the top, that's still functional. Because when I say something's functional, what do I mean? It has syntax. It has the ability to have a tendency which we all understand. So when I play that snap, oh yeah, you know what's happening. The upper pitch is a strong, strong, strong desire to go down. That's what we call a double appoggiatura, right? It has to go down twice to get to its safe, happy place. Technique that Chopin uses all the time. Especially his grace notes. Loves it. See any mazurka ever. Right? Now, here's the funny thing. You take that same chord, and you invert it. Meaning you put the minor third on the bottom, and the major third on top. That's not functional. Because there's no... Our ears can't tell us where the pitches are supposed to move. It just sounds wrong. Like, which one's right? They can't both be right. They're obviously dissonant, right? And if I just one want to move? No. 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 They're stuck. That's a non-functional, non-syntactic position, i.e. non-tone. They can't exist in a tonal world.
Like what you were talking about with Bach, where you would have two different tones.
Exactly. Right? As long as the major one is the lower, then it's still in the world of functional tonality. When the minor one is the lower, it's all of a sudden it really reverts back, and I don't mean this negatively, but it reverts back to just noise and sound. It's not a nag on that. I'm just saying that's what that is. It doesn't have a functional connotation. Which what I mean by that is, like, compared to language, it can't be a word in a sentence. It's just a thing.
That's a question about chord. So obviously, tonal, can you say there's such a thing as a tonal chord versus a modal chord versus a non-syntactical chord?
Yeah, I buy that. I mean, you know, that's a super complicated question, right? But I mean, if you think about taking a standard tonal practice procedure like doing 1-4-5-1, and thinking what would that be in Dorian? We can kind of force that because we are so comfortable with 1-4-5, we can take little variants. But if you push that to an extreme, it won't work. If I do that in Phrygian, I'm gonna think about this for a second. Yeah, give me a second. It'll be no. If I do it in Locrian, it'll be amazing.
Yeah, do Locrian.
Let's do that. So it'll be 4th-5. Yeah. Hold on. It's harder than it seems. Okay, I got it. All right, that would be your 5s, 4 and 5 that are lower, right? Yeah, that's terrible. Anyway, the point is, there's a limit to how much your ears can tolerate before it's like, no, I don't understand this, right? And it's all based on how far you've left the other 10 series behind.
Okay, in terms of the way that the like fa natural hangs on the bottom, and then the fa sharp hangs like in the violin.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, would there be a way to modulate in a way that would make sense, like syntactically?
Oh, I think so, definitely.
Yeah,
you can make that work by a whole number of ways. You know, I mean, that's where enharmonics come into play.
Gotcha.
Right? If we could somehow hear that F natural be changed to an E sharp in our ear via other measures,
mm-hmm.
make a very smooth modulation F sharp.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? But it is not an E sharp. This is why it's so important how you write the pitches and spell them. If this is an E sharp, well, it goes to F sharp. Who cares? Big deal. Whoop, it's called leading tones going to tonics, right? That happens a lot. But the fact that it's fa natural, fa sharp, is a whole other story.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now let's see how that plays out. So he begins this kind of quasi-imitative canon in the D Lydian that he started. This kind of loose imitation. As it builds and builds, where do we eventually arrive? You see the I love that when the contrabass comes in and does it in augmentation. Love that. But then eventually, when we get to the big chord, huge F sharp major chord. Right? Major. Not F sharp minor, F sharp major. That's what your key signature tells you. Although, look what the trumpets do inside of that F sharp major chord that's being held. So what are they doing? That little chaotic line right there, trumpet and trombone, they're giving you both the major and minor versions of that, right? So here's your F sharp major chord, and it's giving you an F sharp minor chord. All that to me says Dorian. And then major, and back to minor. And the mix. So you have no idea what's happening. And remember when I said this is a really hard choral piece? Yeah, here's exhibit A. The choir's here in F sharp major. And they have to just come in and nail a D minor chord. Wow. Okay? That's hard. And even on this recording, it's hard for normal singers. Our singer in our group is giving me the look like,
that is nothing.
Yeah, well, comparatively with what some groups do now, that is true. Especially in 1956, this was really hard. And even as you hear on that recording, which is not the greatest recording in the world, they don't tune those chords perfectly. They try, and it's not perfect, nonetheless. Doesn't this go hand in hand with our idea? We just had an F sharp major chord, and we followed with a D minor. So again, F natural, F sharp, that dialectic, that kind of divine human dialectic that he used in the open with the C flat and the C natural. Right? It's the same story. Notice, when the choir comes back in, what's the text? But nothing changes the. It's back to what it was before. Okay, it's D minor, right? And that very cold minor slash Dorian. What I love is that the orchestra is not done fighting against this. Right? See, the choir sings. And then you still have an F sharp major chord. The low part of the orchestra goes, now we're with the choir. D minor. And the top part of the orchestra, no, we're still right. And you have this incredible tension between two places which are about as far humanly apart as you can be. And what do I mean by that? D Dorian is zero sharps and flats. F sharp major is six sharps. That is literally as far apart as you can possibly be in music. From tonal areas, modal areas. From zero to six. There's no seven, because once you get to seven, you're back around five on the other side, right? Six is the limit. F sharp, G flat. Okay, here's the cadence. Yeah, bottom change. Here's the chord on change. And the orchestra's still trying to fight against it. And for the first time, look at the tenors. Very hard to sing this. If you're the bassist, you're singing me at the top of your range. If the tenors, you're in the mostly high part of your range, singing right next to them. And altos right next to them. It's not easy. The tenors, the sopranos are both. And the tenors themselves make the chroma for the first time. They did. You're like, yeah, they won. But then look at the orchestra. D minor. There it is. F sharp, F natural. Sharp and match. What's it now? You didn't win. It's not over yet. And I guess just imagine how difficult this really is. I want everybody to sing, just hum for me the tenor chord. So here's the first chord. So hum the F natural. And now keep humming it. See how like against your like desire that is to do? That is really, it feels wrong. And that's what it's supposed to be, all right? That's the idea. That's the tension between this divine and human relationship. So, okay. Now, the second half of this movement basically repeats this with some verbal counterpoint and some incredible canonic things. And this is not meant to be a counterpoint lecture, so I won't go on and talk about every one of them, but I will just show you one or two things that was pretty awesome. So look at the bass and tenor canon at the beginning. That's the perfect canon of the unison, right? It's lovely. Now, look at the cellos and contrabasses. They're doing that exact same variant of the chant, but in augmentation and in parallel fourths. Okay, so. Parallel force and going very slowly. Like a hyper augmentation. And even the little tiny things that you see, like looking at the clarinets and bassoons, the little accompanimental gestures, they're also providing little tiny backups for the singers and fragmenting in the orchestra the canon itself as well. So there's nothing on these pages here that is not exactly the chant. You know how hard that is to do? From a contrapuntal point of view, those of you who have written fugues and done invertible and all this stuff, you know that that is incredibly complicated and difficult. So, again, why did this piece take so long to write? Because this passage probably took a year. It's incredibly detailed and complex. Another just difficulty of this piece, and again, why it doesn't get performed so much, super large orchestra, super large choir, and such intricate counterpoint, it's not always the best idea, right? When you do Beethoven 9 as a choir, what are you ready to do? Scream your face off, right? Because that's what that piece is for. And it sounds great, and it's like one of the greatest things that ever be done for choir, and it's awesome, but it's not intricate. And you're not going to mix it up with this. You know what I mean? Just as a compositional thing, take care when you write very complicated composition. Know your forces. Okay, anyway, you can follow the canons along. As you see, for rehearsal 5, we have that contrapuntal motive 2 again. This time in a lovely inversion with itself, a little mirror inversion, which I really love in the sopranos and altos and tenors. Little, again, inversion, kind of, this is what I call mirror canons and mirror inversions, right? Where you take the original motive and you start on one pitch and one of them does it and the other does the mirror opposite. Right, it's a Bartokian technique for the most part, although you'll see it in the musical offering and some other things once in a bit. It's also something you'll see if you look further back. One of my favorite weirdo composers from the ancient times, Heinrich Isaac, is the master of what he calls chaotic palindrome writing, where everything you write is a palindrome and X-shaped. So it's a palindrome this way, and back and forward. Right? Doesn't always sound great. It's pretty impressive. What's impressive about this is that it also sounds great.
What was the name
of that again?
Heinrich Isaac.
Right. What was
the piece?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the technique? It's,
yeah.
It's called Kiasic palindrome. Kiasic is C-H-I-A-S-I-C. It doesn't look like that anyway. Ki
okay.
being the word for X, the letter X in Greek. Right?
Okay.
Kiasic. anyway, as this goes on, we go on and on. Again, we're in this Dorian world and pretty happily there until, just as you might expect, when we get that line again, a human sigh, end of page 8. Look where we are. Right. That B flat's introduced again, just as it was before. And in the very next line, look at the tenors, there's the B natural. Infinite, right? And this time, at the end of the chant, it gives you the picking there. Yeah, that's what we were hoping for last time, right? The orchestra joins in. And crescendo, crescendo, crescendo. Sometimes when you look at an orchestra score, you get a little confused because you're like, that looks like much is going on right there. That's really, really, really loud. Okay, because you got cymbals, crescendo, the double fourth, you got timpani, and all of those low strings. That's and since it's that downbeat, look at where the singers have to jump to. So they're here, and they have to go one. The poor tenors have to jump from fa do fa sol sol la. Brutal. It's absolutely brutal. But again, why? Because look at the text again, but nothing changes these. This is when we go back to our Dorian mode. So that F sharp to F naturals are what I call that fixed contrapuntal motive, third level contrapuntal motive, concept contrapuntal motive. Right? And those poor sopranos too. I mean, they're sitting there listening to the D major chord. That's go. Okay, guys. Just coming at double forte. You better hope you're right. Because I mean, if you're even slightly wrong, it's just an awful. like you can't read music. That's why this is just such a difficult choral piece. I mean, you know, it's. You look at things like Symphony of Psalms and all this, and you think, oh, that's got to be a really hard choral piece. Actually, it's really not so bad for choir. You know, the choir, like the orchestra, has all the heavy lifting in terms of the pitch stuff. The choir, the second movement of that piece is a straight-up fugue in C minor, like straight-up C minor. So that's not that hard. It's when the orchestra plays on top of it that they're like, oh, yeah, no, okay, that's a little harder. I have to make sure I'm still in C minor. This is just physically hard. Physically hard. Okay. Notice that as the choir holds again, D minor chord, the very last eighth note on that page, G flat major. As our dialectic we've had before, right between D minor and G flat slash F sharp. Next page, here's the cadence. Here's the chord again. Sopranos leap up. Going on around. It's such a cool orchestration. The whole orchestra starts going nuts here. Right? What are they doing? They're all doing the chant just like super, super, super fast. Like, look at the cellos. They're going. Right? That's the opening line. Right? Right? Mode 2. Right? So they're all doing that just crazy fast as the choir is holding this incredibly dissonant sound. And when it finally breaks, they go to D major. Alright, F sharp, reach. But look at the last thing the orchestra does. F sharp, F natural. You know there's a fixed tone counterpart mode going on here? I'm not paying attention. It's nice to see something like, you know, it's very rare to let me put it this way. To have an intellectual idea and a musical idea coincide is always what you want. It's very hard to do that and make it not too intellectual. So the fact it was like, well, you know, if I explained it to you, you'd be like, oh yeah, it's great. But so, you know, I don't think a good piece of music needs to have like a program note that's 3 pages long to tell you why it's so great. Right? I think it should be self-explanatory and it should be felt by people no matter what. Now, having said that, it's rare to have an idea like this match up so well musically and intellectually, if that makes sense. Concept-wise, and actually goes on page-wise.
When you listen to it, though, it doesn't have this sort of sensuous musical quality to a lot of it. You can tell there's some other animating force driving a lot of this stuff.
Certainly. Oh, there's no doubt about it. I mean, it's a very violent and dissonant piece for Barber, right? And
Now, as he goes into the second movement, it's going to change a little. So maybe we should look at that, shall we? Take a listen. Second movement's probably the simplest one here. It's just soprano solo the entire time.
Who is it?
Who's the singer?
I'm looking for it. The five note. The original singer who created this was Leah Tien Price. Mm-hmm. It was done with the Boston Symphony, and there's no recording of it. What a shame.
There's no recording?
It's so dumb.
Way to go, Sam.
Yeah, I know, right? Like, turn on the tape.
Yeah, maybe
I
don't
want to
hear
that.
It.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe
listen to the playback.
Still wax
tapes.
Cylinders.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. Move it to.
Stunning is that? You're not going to mistake this for any other composer. Right?
This is Barber being Barber right here.
Yeah. The orchestration is so classically him. Yeah. After all this incredibly huge sound that he made, just almost chamber orchestra-like orchestration. Every little part incredibly detailed and rhythmically so like very complex, isn't it? And I absolutely love his ability to give you something which on the surface like gives the appearance of being very simple. Was actually like incredibly complex. You might look at this and be like, you know, compare this to a Schoenberg orchestra piece and be like, oh man, the orchestra's probably like, this is the easiest thing we've ever done. Like, no, because everything has to be perfect. You can't just be line number 29 in a 45-part counterpoint, right? Like, everybody has to be so tight. And there's even things in this recording you probably hear where like, man, I don't want to line top. I'm sure they spent a lot of time trying to get that right, you know. And that's just a live recording, and yet still there are problems. It's amazing. Complicated that really is. Take it from somebody who tries, I orchestrate a lot like I think Barbara does, and
try to have a great amount of detail in each individual part. And one of the hardest things I have to deal with conductors is saying, like, you need to make sure you give them enough time to rehearse so they really can understand what each how each individual plays into each other. If this is not like a standard big time paintbrush with the big, like, you know, mosaic thing, a la Shostakovich or something like that. This is intricate, 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 which means that everybody really needs to know what they're doing and how they relate to everybody else. Hey, that's a whole other thing for another day. Let's walk through the analysis, shall we? So we just ended this thing, the first movement in D minor. And the first thing we do is get our motive again. And all of a sudden, there's our contrapuntal motive two, right? But now we're just going to start there. Talk about a modulation. It's like, well, that's not really a modulation. It's just kind of force, brute force. Like, we stopped on the pitch, and we're just going to start there. And with the key change, the two sharps and the feel of this opening chord, we're thinking, Dorian again? Are we doing the Dorian? Are we going to be E Dorian? So what are we doing? Are we in D major? Sure feels like it, huh? Excuse me, I've got a little playful cadence. But that's got to be a five chord, right? And where's the one? This one. It's fascinating, right? Look at the horn right there. There's a missing chord there, the first measure of page 13. It should have been tonic. Weren't you really, really, really expecting the B major chord to arrive? I mean, it just like felt like the thing to do.
We played another one.
Oh, sure. Let me play the whole first phrase, and with the chord, I'm pretty 100% sure you expect it. You're in the middle of a song. That would be tonic, with the picking there, or at the very least minor. Here's the minor version. Not really, we really want that picking bad, right? And what's fascinating about it is he doesn't give you either one. He gives you no chord. So you have the full minor dominant, and it just gives you. And then the horn, and we do it again. Look at how the singer comes in, like midway through this phrase. You would think like that's where the singer should have come in, right there, right on the chord. But instead, you've got again hobo doing a little solo. That's the end of their line, right? And then the singer begins. What an elegant elision of those two phrases.
Would you take that from like Forehead?
I would think so. You know, I mean, the two composers which I think Barber learned the most from were Forehead and Debussy. There's no doubt about it. And Forehead with the like incredible intricacy of texture, and Debussy with the elision of phrase. You know, Debussy always is going somewhere. He never comes to a cadence until he's finally done. It's one of his main like gifts, is that it just always moves, 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 moves. You never stop and restart, right? That's just not his MO. And Barber definitely knows how to do that. It's the same. And now here's that same cadence where, remember before, it was missing? And this time, you get the picking there. It's in the heart of all things. That's about as weak a prickly third as you're going to get. The harp down there you can barely hear. And the bassoon's also doing it. You're going to hear that. But look at the position of the chord. And the clarinet doing it. These are A clarinets, right? So they're down the minor third. It's a good, it's a good piece for scoring, too, people. If you want to practice scoring at home, it's got A clarinets, and of course F horns, and B flat trumpets. It's got them. It's got everything. It's fun, fun to do. Keep going. Here, we just finally had that kind of
as I wrote on there, justified picketing. We expected the picketing to occur the first time, we got nothing. Here we got it. So what does that mean? Time to move on. Time to go to part two of this. Alright, here we go. Cool little imitation there in the bass, in the contrabass and the violoncello cello from the soprano. And that sets us up for the big. There we go. First real dominant chord we've had, right? Dominant of the relative major. You think we're going to the relative major? Of course, it's going to be boring. We're expecting D, right? And what do we get in the melody? D sharp. That's a surprise, right? Every one of these surprise harmonies, what's making them surprising? They're not the chord you expected, and the pitch that you needed to make the pickety third has been altered to give you the root of the next chord. Right? So look at the cello, the viola here, solo. How's it going? Yes, big soprano moment. Yes, the change from G sharp to G natural. Here's one of my favorite sexiest chords here. That's a modal progression, right? Another Dorian progression. Minor 1, major 4, major 5. It's like Dorian with the picketing on the living time. Love it. Let me play that again. Here's the Dorian 4. And the leading tone alteration. Then he goes deceptive. My favorite part of this piece, look at that, all the way up top, flute, all the way up top, on the major 7, gives you the actual contrapuntal note. You want a good passing, you want a good, you know, accent and passing time, that F natural wins. Isn't that lovely? So major 7th chord is pushing up, right? It's gonna go up? Nope. So you agree that there's something hard about this vocal piece.
Yeah. Well, I mean, especially like over an orchestra, like that means every range of like all the different parts of your voice have to be very strong.
Exactly.
That's why they have Leontine Price.
Yeah, because she's like one of those weirdo singers that every part of her range is huge.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, to really, and, you know, a lot of sopranos can sing this high A and G and make it just belt over the orchestra, but then you gotta leap down to the F sharp. Yeah, it's like then you got to be basically a mezzo to sing that loud, right? So, I mean, he knew his singer. He wrote for Leontine Price quite a lot.
Yeah.
And you know, she's one of the greatest singers of all time. All right, so then we get up to the end. Notice how many times we're just rotating between this E minor, B minor. Never really quite sure which one is tonic. That's, by the way, a Chopin trick. We're going to talk about this one in the other lecture, but you know, my favorite mazurka. Which one's tonic? Sounds good, right? Tonic? Or is this one? Sounds good. Or is this one? I don't know. She was the first to figure out that you could mix the plagal and the authentic, and you're never really sure which is which. And so that's going on here in this one as well. A lot of good viola solos in this. Viola solos. We have a violist here, which is like incredibly awesome and rare. So you'll agree, viola solo on the fourth string all the way up to the C sharp. Nice. So we still have that sound. After all of this. And if you're not convinced that it's still about major and minor at the same time, look at the horn line here coming up. Okay, a horn solo. So what did he just do? Major, then minor, and then back to major, right? Right. It's down a fifth, the horn. So he started on Ray sharp, as your picky third major, but in the second measure, he leaps back up to Ray natural, as your minor. And at the end, you get the picky third with the hanging bitch back too. How about that for a second movie? But you see, it's kind of, it's like a laser focus on this concept for me in this case. You know what I mean? Like, this split third is so incredibly active in almost every measure and every decision-making process of the piece. To me, that's, you know, a composer who, whether consciously or not, is really, like, well aware of his materials as well.
Yeah. Since you mentioned that, I mean, I was thinking back to, like, one of the first lectures and about how the Baroque was more about unity.
Yeah.
And it's since gotten to, like, more disparate
Definitely.
Elements.
Definitely.
So, I mean, when we say, like, well, was he thinking about that? It's like, it's kind of hard to imagine Barber, who was, like, in the throes of, like, right after World War II at that, probably the most disjointed and disparate time of all,
mm-hmm. yeah.
could have been thinking about unity.
I agree. That's very well said.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to realize that Barber was, he's one of the only tonalist composers in this time period which had any success,
mm-hmm.
right? I mean, you know, I grew up, like, sounding the trumpet for Poulenc, saying, like, Poulenc is a canon composer, we should all listen to Poulenc. And all of my teachers, except for my actual real teacher in the end, were like, ugh, Poulenc is like crappy parlor music. Like, we're going to study serious music at this school. And now look at this, 20 years later, everybody knows Poulenc's
yeah.
in the canon. And it's amazing. And I was like, I was first on that, people. Just saying. But I mean, why? Because there was an anti-tonal bias in the 20th century that still exists.
Right.
It's fading quickly now, thank the Lord. But, you know, when I was a student, and some of you who are a little older probably had this when you were in school, too, that writing tonal music was just like, what are you saying? Are you a child? Nobody does this anymore. So you got to imagine how it felt in the 50s and 60s, right, when serialism was at its apex for people like Barber.
What did
now,
people think of that?
Hmm?
What did his contemporaries?
Well, they didn't give him a lot of respect. I mean, you know, there was this whole New York kind of cadre of composers, which included Copland and Virgil Thompson and Roger Sessions and Bill Schumann. It was the Juilliard clique at that time, right? And none of them gave Barber any love. When Barber's first opera, Vanessa, was chosen to open the Metropolitan Opera, their very first concert, everybody was up in arms because he wasn't from Juilliard. He went to Curtis. He was in the Curtis first class. He was in their first class ever, right? The very first year Curtis opened. Talk about being in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
Like, just when he's ready to go to school in his own hometown, pops what will become the best school in the country. Like, man, good luck for him.
The lucky best.
Yeah, it's really amazing. There was also, just as a side note, you guys know how much I revere Nadia Boulanger. Barber never studied with Boulanger, which is kind of surprising. But he wrote her a letter at one point inviting her to come and teach at Curtis and, like, to move to the United States. Basically, before, when it looked like the war was about to break out, like, a lot of people fled Europe and came here, and a lot of people fled Russia and came here. That's why all the Russian composers ended up being American, except for Paul Shostakovich. But anyway, should have gotten that one good. But can you imagine, like, just one of those things, like, how history would be different? Boulanger supposedly thought about it for a long time, and her mother, Boulanger's mother, was pretty old and pretty sick, and she couldn't, you know, make the trip across the ocean. So she's like, no, I'll stay.
Her mother had died.
Yeah, her mother, yeah, it's one of those things. Her mother had died like a year or two earlier.
That was
she probably would have
accident.
I know, right? she would have taught at Curtis for the next 60 years.
Wow. Yeah. We'd be like 30.
Yeah, but then it'd just be like the American musical life, so.
That's true. And then you'd go Ema.
Probably still be there today.
Probably
still be there today.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good point. Anyway, there's little quirks of history. So, as you probably tell, there's a lot more of these pieces. I'm not going to get a chance to go through the whole thing, but I did want to show you a little bit of the next movement before we call it a night. I hate to interrupt movements in the middle, but really from this point on, there's no place to stop this piece for the next 15 minutes. The next two movements are insanely tight and continuous. But there are two other things I want to show you, and one has to do very much with what we were just talking about. Now, you might say, Barber, yeah, tonal composer and blah, blah, blah. And did that mean he eschewed everything that was going on around him? No. He, very much like Britain, got a whole bunch of crap from the hardcore serialists because they would use 12-tone rows in their music and just not write 12-tone pieces. And in the next excerpt I'm going to play, if you're paying attention, you might find a 12-tone row or two.
Page
is
on? What page is
right? We'll start on page 20, everybody.
I'm just going to play just a couple of pages of the story here.
Page 20? Not rehearsal 20, but page 20. Basically where we just stopped. Everybody okay? Okay, here we go. Jesus. Speech just keeps going and going. From this point on, it gets crazier and louder and crazier and louder. It goes nuts. And I highly encourage you to get to know all of it. Now, I just want to talk about what we just heard, because it's a little insane, isn't it? Again, super hardcore all bass. Could you, Rebecca, just tell the crossing to get together with Philadelphia Richmond and make a good recording of this?
It'd be so awesome.
I mean, come on. It'd be like freaking
so
perfect.
Much better than that choir.
I know. I
sound
agree.
Like they're all, like, singing.
Yeah, they sound like rah, 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 rah.
Robert Shaw.
Agreed. Anyway, it's all I could find. It's the best. I listened to five recordings of this, and this is the best one I could find. Anyway, so we start with this B major. This is back at page 20, right? So, what's the progression here? What a killer progression that is. Isn't that gorgeous?
Yeah.
So, again, a little taste of the modal from the B major going to the A major gives you that Mixolydian feel, right? But then to the F major provides, on the outside, the F sharp to F natural we've been talking about the whole time. And it's the sopranos who have the tough job of tuning those half steps. Right? Changes the position and doubling of the chord, which, if you know anything about my positions on doubling, mean that the modulation's about to happen. sharp major chord, by the way. That's the other day. And now. So what's he doing here? What are these type of chords? They feel like we've had these before, haven't we? Doesn't this feel like we've encountered this type of harmony before? It's very, very similar to what we did in the last move, right? Really fluctuating on two chords, the Mixolydian, kind of lowered seventh major chord that we keep hearing, which could be, I don't want to get too fancy, but if you're thinking about either Dorian or tonal, it would either be four and one or it would be seven and the other, right? And then rotating between those two. So you're never really quite sure which one's tonic and which one isn't. It's like whichever one we land on and stop on, it's like, oh, I guess that's it. And that's a fascinating place to be because it creates this gray area for the harmony to slide around it. Pay very close attention to the doublings, though, and also the motions between one and three. That's often what he's getting at. So right there, this is the beginning of page 12. That's a transposition to the one we did before, a little even crazier, right? Because we have G sharp in there moving to A flat, both as chord tones. Hard to pull that off, by the way. And back to F major. Figured out, and you're like, I've never heard this before. He's gonna do this, but now this time, you just jump to the three and then the major. Look at the position, soprano. And nothing sounds better than the C major chord in the orchestra, right? So here it is. I mean, I've never played the cello, I've always wanted to, but that's all I really, really ever wanted to do was just go. Why would you not want to?
Then you'd love the Pocketball Cannon.
Yeah, it's a good one. Yeah. If I could play the cello, I'd play Pocketball Cannon. I don't want to listen to it.
I'm sure it's great the first few hundred times.
Yeah, that's right. That's probably right.
That's how many times you play it once.
Now, look at the next impossible thing that the choir has to do. Holding a C major chord while the orchestra plays. Yeah, that's not hard. That's not easy. And then what are they doing? They're leaping back to B major. It's that half-step relationship. This is not a chroma relationship here. But notice a little note with that scissor. Because what he doesn't want, which a lot of conductors would probably do, you're holding the chord. He wants it just as an incredible surprise. Like, whoa, what the hell just happened? It almost feels like a harmonic effect on the piano. Meaning, if I do this, has that effect? Really?
Like a Doppler effect.
Right. Like, what the hell just happened? Like half of all the sound checked out, and there's just the background overtones.
Like, that's kind of like the due to you like resonances.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's a piece I actually thought about putting on the list.
Oh my god!
Yeah, I do wish that piece. I know, I might. Maybe I'll do that this spring.
Cool.
The DTU resonances. I actually really like this. That's okay.
It's a good one.
He's the kind of the heir to Messianism. Now, last thing I want to talk about. Anybody spot the 12-tone row? You want 12-tone row shopping? Yeah.
That's what we get next, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Now, this is a magical passage here. After the B major. You're like, whoa. They didn't go back to the home key? Oh, but the orchestra finishes. And what's the first pitch in the... We get the piano for the first time in this piece. And look at the piano part. Then return the big back on the way. That's your 12-tone rows. Now you might be like, what? What's the 12-tone row doing in this piece? It's been subtonal. Now, if you say that, you're missing the point. It's not been subtonal. It's been tonal and modal. But there's a quote by Leonard Bernstein about 12-tone writing that I always liked a lot. It's in one of his famous Norton lectures.
where somebody asked, some like, you know, you ever seen the Norton Lectures of Bernstein? They're really worth looking at. I mean, they're kind of like designed to be for like the layperson a little bit. Because people ask questions and stuff. Anyway, some lady gets up, she's like, I don't understand how I'm supposed to listen to 12 tones. It sounds so hard and I don't understand it, or something like that. Right? And he's like, well, first of all, 12 tones has been going on forever. And as we all know, Bach used 12 tones in the construction of the world temple. So that's nothing new. But he made a good point. He's like, composers in the Romantic era did it all the time too. But why did they do it? They did it when they wanted to produce some type of like quasi-supernatural effect. When they wanted to feel like this untetheredness from the real world. Hmm. And I always liked that. I was like, that's interesting. You know, because that is one of the things that happens in 12-tone writing in its purest form. Not 12-tone in Baird, 12-tone in tonalized, 12-tone in its absolute form. The idea is a total untethering from a tonal relationship, where there is no tendency of pitch, right? Now, you can manipulate that a billion ways, see the 20th century. But that in its raw form is kind of what it's about. And that's exactly kind of what happens right here, which I really like. You've got a B major chord hanging out here. And you've got a tenor solo, which, by the way, is exactly the motive. Look at what they said. There's both of them, right? You got F sharp, D sharp, D natural, F natural. That's both of them. Tough singing, by the way. Solo, I'd be like, oh yeah, sure. Those poor singers, my head's rough. And at the same time that that's all happening, you have this 12-tone riff. So you start first against the B major. And how beautiful is it in that hemiola effect of the 3/8 notes? Patterns of 3/8 notes in fourths.
Bernstein used like the Faust symphony opening as like an example of
that's a good one. I have to look at that piece again. I haven't looked at that in ages. I used to love that when I was a kid. It's a great piece. So, in any case, you know, Britain does the same exact thing. We're going to do later in the season, Midsummer Night's Dream, and we're going to see 12-tone done in a completely different context. But I like to point out things like this because, first of all, Barber took a lot of crap for this stuff. You know, I mean, the hardcore serialists were like, oh, God, thanks for stealing our thing. Yeah, making it pretty. Yeah, like, and Barber's like, look, buddy, I studied your music. I took what I liked. You know, which is, by the way, what everyone has always done for all time. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. You learn whatever you can. You know, when I sometimes meet, especially when you meet young students or something, that I was like, well, you know, you should know Prolude now. And they're like, oh, God, I hate Prolude now. It's so boring. It's ugly. And I'm like, okay, well, you know, those are not good things to think or say, by the way. But, you know, you take what you can from every single piece. If you don't want to write Screction with them, don't write Screction with them. Nobody's putting a gun to your head. However, there might be a lot to learn from that piece. And in fact, I think there is a ton to learn from it.
At least know why you don't like it.
Exactly. Yeah. So this is all part of us striving to become more educated musicians. Yeah. You know. Now, I won't go on and on, because I'd like to, you know, we could spend literally 3 more hours going over the next 3 movements, and I highly encourage you to do that. Because the, like, every good quasi-cantata, this piece ends with a chorale. Mm-hmm. So, the challenge I put to you is, look, you don't have it because I got lazy and didn't copy all 100 pages of this, but,
Will you
want me to put the whole thing on? Yeah, I can send you the rest. I'd love for you to look at the chorale and see where these contrapuntal notes have gone to in there. See how they like express themselves in their final state, because it's very beautiful. And it concludes this piece in an incredibly unique way. I was going to end with that, talking about that, but I was like, you know what? I think you should look at it. I think you'll see it right away. Since we've been so, I hope, clear about, you know, what these motives are and how they've been used. Any questions?
The embellishment.
Yeah.
Where does that come from?
What embellishment do you mean?
When you write embellishment,
Oh, when I wrote Embellishment? I think I was just so impressed about that free melodic embellishment there and how beautiful that was in the voice. I think that was a personal comment. you mean when I wrote Ornamentation?
Ornamentation, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think when I read that, I was like, wow, note to self, steal that gesture. It's so gorgeous. But that didn't have anything to do with the analysis, sorry. That was just a note to me to study later.
I know it's not actually like a chromatic sequence, but like, could that 12-tone passage in the piano,
mm-hmm.
like, do you think that it could be kind of viewed as in a similar way, and like maybe that's why a serialist didn't like it, or one of the reasons why serialists didn't
Certainly.
Like it.
Yeah,
it was,
I mean, anytime you have a 12-tone row, you obviously have very symmetric positions you can split it into.
Yeah.
Right? And so by doing something like this where he chooses the parallel fours, you pick any interval and you just do it 12 times, you get all 12 pitches, right? Any chromatic interval.
Yeah.
So to take the fours and just split them into three like this.
Right.
I mean, some people would be like, that's like the simplest division of the row ever. You
right.
could take a much more complex one.
Right.
But I would argue, that may be true, I'm not disagreeing with that, but I would argue that at least those groupings of three are far, far against the metrics of the meter.
Yeah,
like,
against
the 6-4 and 7-4, which, you know, provides an extra layer of complexity.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, having that against what the singers are doing and everything else is just, yeah. But
it's
like,
stomach,
yeah. No, it's just kind of
That's a good point.
Because it does, in that sense, kind of register more as like an effect.
Oh, I think it definitely does.
Yeah.
I mean, it is definitely overlaid on top of this passage.
Yeah.
Right? When the choir finally comes back in after this long solo passage, we're going to start getting those chords again.
Yeah.
Right? And the 12-tone row will not be present. Although, it will make an appearance at the end of this piece again.
Mm-hmm.
So, I just love that he has the freedom to use that element when he wants it.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, I think that that's something that people don't give tonal composers of this time period enough credit for.
Mm-hmm.
It does give it that otherworldliness.
Exactly. And that's why I love that Bernstein quote. I mean, this is one of those passages where it's like, I've never heard any texture like this. You know,
mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
let's not even forget about how great the orchestration is. Okay, the solo cello moving with the tenor solo, and then the violin, xylophone and piano together. It's a lot of sound work. And the clarinet tremolos underneath the whole thing. It's a winning page of orchestral score right there. But, excellent. Any other questions, guys? Yeah.
I do have a stupid question to ask.
Not at all.
So in the first movement, we have the D minor chord right at the beginning.
Uh-huh.
It's D minor on the bottom, and then there's F sharp two or three octaves above it, where it would fit in the Overstone series.
Yes.
And then if you go to rehearsal six, he inverts that. And we have the major third at the bottom and the minor third up at the top.
Oh,
is that just a thing that happens in the first movements, or does he use that structurally somewhere else?
Good question.
Mm.
That's a very good question. The inversion of that.
I feel like it
powerful.
Has formal significance.
I think you're right about that. It definitely separates this passage from the one that's like it before. We never heard right about that. And you know, the inversion of contrapuntal motives is one of the natural thing to do with these guys. Right,
mm-hmm.
It's like, you know, it's the first contrapuntal gesture is what inverted. So I think there's no doubt about that. It definitely occurs in a major way towards the end of this piece. So I think that's a very astute point. Good point that I'm making note of that in my own school.
I think the other thing that's really cool there is we have a D minor and F sharp major at the beginning, and then B major and D minor here.
Right.
There's a lot of double chromatic median relationships going on.
100%.
Cool.
It is cool, isn't it? And it's reflective of the motive. Because it's like, once you have that motive in your head, it's not that you just use it in a chord or something, right? But then you think about, like, what could the juxtaposition of those two pitches give you harmony-wise? How could you use them? That's why there's all these moves to the medium, right? Because if it's the third that's always being changed in a chord, then you may think, well, what if we use that as our new tonic, our new root? And you have all those immediate relationships that go back and forth. That's why you get the... classic chromatic medium. So, yeah.
Just Waldo or something.
It is just Waldo.
Yeah,
it does
kind of sound like that.
Yeah. Great point. Well, everybody, thank you very much. Hope it was helpful. Hope you enjoyed it. No, thank you, people.